Good morning, everyone joining us online. Thanks for being here. Feel free to share this feed, invite others, tag others as you watch with us, and we will be getting started here in just a few minutes.
Thank you.
Good morning. Hi, Gene. I see you waving there. Hi. Good to see you. Good morning, everyone.
Morning.
Yeah, there we go. You can talk. It's okay. It's not prohibited in here, even with the masks on and everything. And good morning to everybody who's joining us online. A reminder to share this and invite others to join us, too. It's a little too late for y'all to do that, but that's okay. We are glad that you are here in whatever way you are worshiping with us. We have a special day today with a baby dedication, which we are excited for. Always a joyous moment in the life of the church, too. And I just want to say thank you for following our guidelines and safety protocols just to keep everybody healthy and protected as best we can, for keeping your masks on while inside. Obviously, I have mine off while I'm talking, but for helping us with that, for spreading out, that is huge for us, and for not lingering too long after the service. But go ahead and give folks space as you make your way outside. And now that we have a beautiful day outside, it's a great way to visit with others and see church family that maybe you haven't seen in a while. So thank you for abiding by those. And for the folks joining us online from wherever you are, I guess y'all can do whatever you want to. But for here, at least, I appreciate what y'all are doing for us. I also want to thank you for your faithfulness and your generosity. Already this year, we are well on our way to reaching our February giving goal. And that is what allows us, that is the fuel. Your giving is the fuel that propels our missions and ministries, not only within the church, but in the much larger community. And one of those is coming up soon, our Crop Hunger Walk. This is an interfaith partnership with other communities of faith around Greenville, and it raises funds for hunger relief around the world, but also for those facing food insecurity right here in our city. One of the main, the main designees of these funds is an organization called Loaves and Fishes, which supplies food for many of our food pantries and food banks right here in town. It is a virtual walk this year, best kind, in my opinion. So you can do it from wherever you are, whenever you do. The target date is March 21st. But if you would like to join the Augusta Heights team, you can go online and do that. Or you can talk to Chuck Childs. Chuck, can you give us a wave? There he is. Good-looking man over there behind the mask. He is our team captain this year. So Chuck can get you more information. We've got some brochures and donation envelopes outside the sanctuary doors. But thank you for helping us to support that. And just a reminder that you can give online through PayPal. You can go to the church's website and give that way. Or we do have offering plates near the doors where you can drop it in a check. Or you can mail one later on this week. And we appreciate all that you do and all that you allow us to do as a church. I want to remind you of the prayer requests we have printed in our worship bulletin. Keep those folks in your prayers, but also a couple more to add. Gary Green is having an eye surgery this morning, rather unexpected, but should be home this afternoon. But please keep him in your prayers as he undergoes that for a smooth surgery and an easy recovery. And then we also want to keep Regina Fox in our prayers. Lynn told me this morning that she is fighting shingles. And if you've ever had shingles or know someone that has, it is not pleasant. So please keep Regina in your prayers as well. I guess somewhat ironically, we are having our Lenten worship series on responding to pain. And as you know from these prayer requests from folks like Regina, from our own lives and in our world, we all experience and encounter pain. Today, we are going to look at embracing pain. And so as we do, as we begin our time of worship, may we prepare our hearts and minds to encounter the God who embraces us and who will never let us go. Let's worship. Thank you.
And a woman spoke, saying, "Tell us of pain." And he said, "Your pain is the breaking of the shell that encloses your understanding. Even as the stone of the fruit must break, that its heart may stand in the sun, so must you know pain. And could you keep your heart in wonder at the daily miracles of your life, your pain would not seem less wondrous than your joy. And you would accept the seasons of your heart, even as you have always accepted the seasons that pass over your fields. And you would watch with serenity through the winters of your grief. Much of your pain is self-chosen. It is the bitter poison by which the physician within you heals your sick self. Therefore, trust the physician and drink his remedy in silence and tranquility. For his hand, though heavy and hard, is guided by the tender hand of the unseen. And for the cup he brings, though it burns your lips, has been fashioned of the clay which the potter has moistened with his own sacred tears."
Of sweet Vivian. I pray that you will show us what Jesus meant when he said that you have to save, you have to lose your life to save it, and show us how to embrace pain and then how to help other people do that as well. In your name we pray. Amen.
Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
Can we all please stand and let's join in together in singing our opening hymn, "When I Survey the Wondrous Cross."
And for contempt.
And I hope that y'all were able to go home and sometime this past week bury your hallelujahs. Well, today we're going to add a very important part of our garden. Now, when you think of a garden, what do you think of? Flowers, yes. Grass, yes. What else? Yay, you're going to say grass? Food, yes. There can be a vegetable garden, yes. Dirt, yep. So you know what? We have our dirt, but we are missing one of the key ingredients to our garden. And for this garden, it's going to be grass, like Lennon said. So today, we are going to plant our grass. And Miriam, I'm going to ask you, since you belong to me and you can be close to me, I'm going to ask you to come hold my microphone. Okay? You can stand up. Yes, there we go. All right. So, I know y'all might not be able to see. Why don't you just go back this way? I'll come forward. Okay, so look, we have our garden here. Right here, look, right here. Here we go. So we're going to, this is the grass seed. And in your boxes, you're going to have a baggie of grass seed, just like this. Now, there's a lot of grass seed here, but we need to plant a lot so that over the coming weeks, we'll have lots and lots and lots and lots of grass. Now, can I leave it like that? Do you think it'll grow like that? Now, first, before I do that, that's very good, Marion. First, before I do that, I've got to get it down into the soil. Because like Lennon said, you can't have a garden without soil. So we're going to put it down in there. And then Marion brought up a very good point that it cannot grow without water. So look, I have a spray bottle of water, which is very helpful so that you don't drown the grass seed. We can just be helpful to turn it and make it come over. Here we go. Oh, yep, here we go. So you want to make sure you put plenty of water on it. What else does grass seed or flowers need to grow? It needs air. Sun, very good. Yes, Lennon knew it. As soon as she said it, she was like, wait a minute. It's the big yellow thing in the sky that we have not seen very much of recently. But we definitely need sun. So we need water, we need sun, and we need a lot of that in order for it to grow. So over the next couple weeks, we're going to begin to see this grass seed begin to grow. So I want to encourage you, so like the seeds, right now they're down in the soil, we can't really see them, we don't really know what it's going to look like when it begins to grow. And this is sort of kind of like when we are learning things, like in school. My kids say, why do I have to learn math? I'm never going to use it. It's not important. However, as they get older and begin doing more things, they will be needing that math knowledge that they have. And sometimes when we learn things, we wonder, what's the purpose of this? This isn't going to make any difference in my life. I don't understand why I have to learn this. And that's kind of like the seeds here. We don't know what it's going to look like. We don't know how it's going to come up and look. And when we learn things, like through Lent, as we're learning about Jesus and learning about ourselves, we may not understand why we're learning those things. But as we grow and as we continue on our journey with God,
we'll begin to see why we learn the things we do and how we can use them in our lives and how important they are. So this week, it can be today, it can be sometime this week, I want for you to plant your grass seed, and I want for you to do your devotions, your families, and talk about the scripture passage for this week in our box for this week. Yes, ma'am. I see flowers in your crown, yes. And we will have flowers eventually in our garden, right? Yes. And eventually we will have grass seed. So I hope that y'all will join us again next week. Maybe, maybe just maybe, the grass seed will start growing. Okay? Will y'all pray with me? Dear God, we thank you for this day. We thank you for this opportunity for us to come together to learn about you. God, there are things that you teach us every day, things that we learn from other people, and sometimes we don't quite understand how they will affect our lives. But God, continue to be with us. Help us to grow. Help us to learn so that one day we may be able to use the stories that we have learned and all the experiences we have had to make a difference in someone else's life. It is in your son's name that we pray.
That is my specialty. Today, like I mentioned earlier, is a joyous day, a wonderful day in the life of our church as we celebrate the birth and dedication of another child. I was looking back at this, y'all. We have not been able to do this since January of 2020. It has been that long, 14 months almost, and we are so thrilled. We've had several children that have been born into our church since then, and we are excited today to celebrate with Taji and Bradley Boulefont. So if y'all will come forward and bring up what I may be jinxing myself here, but she just seems like the happiest little baby right now. So I'm sure that, you know, as soon as we start doing this, she's going to bust out. But this is Vivian. Hi, Vivian. Put my mask back on since you're up here, okay? Today we celebrate, maybe we can turn you down later. Today we celebrate with Taji. We celebrate with Taji and Bradley. They bring Vivian to be dedicated to the church, to be dedicated to God here in the context of worship, just as the prophet Samuel was brought by his mother Hannah, and even the child Jesus was brought by Mary and Joseph. And as we do, just because of COVID and everything, I'm gonna let Taji walk around with me, with Vivian, so y'all can all get a really good look at her. So come on, let's take a little walk. And we are excited. I want you all to see just how adorable she is, as you can easily see. They've got some family here today with them to celebrate. Family, could y'all, if you wouldn't mind, stand maybe? So they've got some wonderful family support here to celebrate this big day. Very exciting. Very exciting. Thank you, Amy. Thank you all for being here. I want you all to get a good look at this girl. She is, it's kind of amazing to think that, you know, she's really only seen people in masks. Right? And it's amazing how she doesn't even know yet how weird y'all are beneath the masks. So I'm sure that's going to be a big shock one day. But we are so thrilled. She is celebrating her first birthday today. And folks online, I want to make sure that y'all get a good look at her too. So just, you know, Smile for the camera. Oh, now she's going to be a little camera shy. There you go. Wave to everybody this way. She already knows it. See, she's a Zoom pro already. Already. They come today. This dedication is about making a covenant. It's about making promises. This family promised making promises to God and to the church, to Vivian, but also you making promises to them. So, first of all, let's start with Haji and Bradley. Do you recognize Vivian as a gift from God, God's beloved child created in God's image? You can say, we do. Do you promise to do all you can to help her become the person that God created her to be and the person Christ calls her to be? And do you covenant with one another and with God and with this community of faith to teach her the stories and sing her the songs of faith, to give her every opportunity to teach her how to love God and love others and to know Christ, hoping that one day she will embrace him as his follower? All right, so church, now it's your turn. And folks online, you can type it in, we do, after each statement. So people of God at Augusta Heights, as members of this church, will you covenant with the Bulifants and with God and with Vivian to do the following? Do you recognize Vivian as a gift from God, created as God's beloved child in God's image?
We do.
Do you promise to do all that you can to help her become the person God created her to be and the person Christ calls her to be?
We do.
And will you covenant with one another and with God and with Vivian and her family that you will do all that you can to help her know how to love God and love others? Will you tell her the stories and sing her the songs of faith, giving her opportunities to know God and hopefully one day to embrace Christ as his follower?
We do.
Wonderful. Christine has a few mementos to offer them for this special day from our church and our children's ministry.
So on dedication of our children and our church, we as a church give you a children's story Bible so that you can begin to read the stories and teach her the stories of Jesus. Also, inside the Bible is a letter written by Greg for her to open on her 10th birthday to remind her of this day and what this day meant to y'all and to our church. And as she begins to understand more and more what it means to be a follower of Christ. So this is a letter that she will open near her 10th birthday. And during this pandemic, they're trying to figure out ways to welcome babies into our congregation when they were born. So it's just fitting that on her first birthday, the day that I actually met her a year ago today, we give her a book called Prayers for Faithful Families. And these are prayers for everyday life that you can begin to say at bedtime or when she falls down and scrapes her knee. Or if she becomes an athlete, that she can pray as she goes on the court or on the field, or if she's a musician, that she can pray as she plays the beautiful music of God. So this is a book that we hope that you will use in your family along with the Bible as you continue to allow her to grow and be the person that God has made her to be.
Y'all can't see it, but she's just down here grinning up at us. I think because she knows what's coming next. This is a quilt made by our Piece by Piece quilt ministry. They make one original and special for every baby that is dedicated. And this one is for Vivian. Appropriate because we've got, you know, Bijou Dental Spa, the business that her parents have built together right up here. And houses as they are building a home, in the process of building a home for this growing family. So we are thrilled and hope that she will get lots of enjoyment out of that. And then on the back is a little pocket that contains a handkerchief embroidered with the church's monogram that we hope one day she will be able to use when she is baptized. So this is for y'all. We hope that you will love it. And we hope that all of these will be reminders of our love for her and for y'all and the promises that we have made here today. As we close this dedication, let's close with a word of prayer, but as we do, I want you to keep your eyes open so that you can see this precious child and family as we lift them up in our prayers. And because we are all a part of this process and this dedication, at the end of the prayer, I will invite you to say something like, just as we are promised in Scripture, that before we love God, and then you will respond, we will all respond with God first loved us. So, let us pray. God, giver of all life and love, and babies who clap and smile and giggle, we give you thanks for Vivian Francis, Lord, your beloved child created in your image. As her parents hold her, as we look at her and see her, we can see your divine touch within her. She looks just like you. We thank you for this amazing and precious gift. Vivian, and for you, Christ came into this world. For you, he walked the roads of Galilee. For you, he climbed Calvary's Mount. For you, he bore the cross. And for you, he was raised again into new life. But you don't know anything about that. You just sit there playing with your dad. Which just proves the promises of Scripture. That before we love God, God first loved us. Thanks be to God. So may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace now and forevermore. Amen. We love you, sweet girl. Y'all can return to your seat. You can come up later and get all this stuff. That's no problem.
Thank you.
What a wonderful day. So let us continue as we continue in worship. Let us continue to seek and hopefully encounter in this time and in this place, in the presence of one another, God who embraces us all.
Thank you.
Today's scripture reading was from Mark 8, 31 through 38, inclusive. Then he began to teach them that the Son of Man must undergo great suffering and be rejected by the elders, the chief priests, and the scribes, and be killed, and after 3 days rise again. He said all this quite openly, and Peter took him aside and began to rebuke him. But turning and looking at his disciples, he rebuked Peter and said, "Get behind me, Satan, for you are setting your mind not on divine things, but on human things." He called the crowd with his disciples and said to them, "If anyone wants to become my followers, let them deny themselves and take up their cross and follow me. For those who want to save their life will lose it. And those who lose their life for my sake and for the sake of the gospel will save it. For what will it profit them to gain the whole world and forfeit their life? Indeed, what can they give in return for their life? Those who are ashamed of me and of my words in this adulterous and sinful generation, of them the Son of Man will also be ashamed when he comes in the glory of his Father with the holy angels." This is the word of the Lord.
Hang on. this life. So hang on. Well, everybody hurts. Sometimes everybody cries.
Stop putting Matt before the sermon. It's just unfair to follow that. You know, I thought this would have been one of Jesus's most famous sayings. If any want to become my followers, let them deny themselves and take up their cross and follow me. Right? I mean, you've heard it before. It seems fairly well known. It's even become the basis for a common idiom, which unfortunately gets misused, a bit of a pet peeve for me, but I suppose that's just my cross to bear. See what I did there? I just thought that this saying of Jesus would be a little more widely known, but after a few quick Google searches for things like Jesus' best known sayings and top 10 Jesus quotes, this one didn't show up on any list. Now, do unto others, love your enemies, for God so loved the world, I am the way, the truth, and the life. All of those were there, but not take up your cross. And we know why, right? This morning's passage leads off with Jesus predicting suffering and death. Not only predicting it, but telling his disciples, his closest companions, his best friends, that it is unavoidable, that the Son of Man must undergo rejection and suffering and death. And so I think Peter responds for most of us when he says, no, you don't want to do that, because we don't like suffering. And understandably, to state the obvious, pain hurts. It's uncomfortable. And we spend much of our time and attention and energy, much of our lives, doing what we can to prevent it or to avoid it for ourselves and for people we love. A couple of weeks ago, our son Yates wanted to do one of those virtual rides on an exercise bike. The kind where the screen shows an actual road and then the bike changes the incline and the resistance to match the route that you're riding along. And he wanted to bike over Paris Mountain. Now, as somebody who has actually biked over Paris Mountain and suffered greatly doing so, I thought, you don't want to do that. So as he started his ride, I started lowering the resistance a little bit, make it a little bit easier on him, maybe save him a little pain. But Susie rebuked me. Stop intervening. Let him try it. Let him do it. Let him have the experience. And he did. And he finished. And he was even more proud of that accomplishment than he would have been if it hadn't been as hard, if he hadn't suffered a little bit. And Yates, you did suffer a little bit, right? Trying to do that. Okay, just making sure. I had the same instinct as Peter to avoid the pain, to bypass it if at all possible, to prevent it, or in Peter's case, even the talk of it. And when we can't, especially in our modern world, we will often try to numb the pain that we experience, or numb ourselves to the pain of others. We have an epidemic, literally, as opioids, drugs that are meant, designed to lessen or numb pain, are being overprescribed and overused and abused. We turn away from the bad news we see on our TVs or our computers, or we tell ourselves, man, that's a shame. But that's a problem for somebody else. It's just awful, but I can't do anything about it. We are confronted with systemic injustices and inequities and the pain that they cause others, pain that we may be complicit in a way, but we get defensive or dismissive. Or we anesthetize our own inner pain, finding comfort in food and drink or seeking the salve of wealth and well-being and being well-liked, of the admiration of others, of all the stuff that makes us feel better. But then sometimes we can come to a point at which we accept pain, even if it's only reluctantly or begrudgingly. Like I mentioned last week, in Buddhism, the first step on the path to enlightenment is to accept that life is suffering. We can't avoid it completely, so we might as well accept it. And in fact, accepting pain as a part of life is part of being healthy and human. There are entire psychotherapies built around that very principle. But if you'd like a less existential example, let me offer this. When I was in college playing rugby, I broke my sternum. And yes, that is as painful as it sounds. And no, I don't recommend it. I don't recommend the broken sternum part. I highly recommend rugby. It's awesome. I love it. But anyway, after I was injured, I had to do physical therapy exercises, which hurt, frankly. But I suffered through them. I accepted it because it was pain with a purpose. It was part of my healing. I didn't like it. I was able to accept it. And now, today, I'm just barely getting to the point of accepting Furman missing an extra point and then fumbling on fourth down yesterday to lose to VMI. I'm sorry, Michael. You're not there yet. I understand. We'll get there. But then here comes Jesus in this passage, calling us to go even further. Not only to not avoid or not numb the pain, not even just to accept it, but to embrace pain. To take up our cross, to deny ourselves and follow Him. It's a hard teaching. It's hard to wrap our head around, much harder to shape our lives around, to embrace pain. Who wants pain? Who wants to suffer? Not me, not Peter, not most of us. But it's worth pointing out that Jesus doesn't say here, seek out a cross and then follow me. This is not an invitation to look for or languish in or provoke or prolong pain and suffering. Instead, Jesus says, take up your cross and follow me. Assumes that, first of all, there already is a cross. There already is pain and suffering. And two, that following Jesus will entail some of that pain, some kind of suffering. The call is not to go seeking it out, but to take up the pain that we all too often, all too well already know. Not to be a passive object of the pain we experience in our lives or encounter in the world, but to become an active agent in our lives, in the world, even amidst our pain, even as we follow Jesus along the way that leads to liberation and restoration, and health, and wholeness, and new life. The way of love. And if we are not willing to embrace pain, to follow Him, our own pain, others' pain, in one way or another, then we will not be able to fully experience love either. Because love and suffering are connected. The band Nazareth had it right in 1976. Glad I got to warm up with a bide with me for that. But the truth is, love does actually hurt. Researchers have found this. They found that the feeling of heartbreak literally hurts us in a way similar to getting hit in the face. And then taking pain medication like Tylenol can actually relieve emotional pain. We feel it in much of the same way. There is this connection between love and suffering. Because the more we open ourselves up to love, the more vulnerable we are to the possibility of pain, of being hurt. I mean, when you see a stranger in pain, you may feel badly for them, you may have pity on them, but when you see someone you love in pain, it hurts you too. You cry for them, you cry with them, you pray for them, you pray with them, you feel with them. We're very aware of that kind of connection this morning as we dedicated Vivian. Because any mother who has given birth knows the love she feels for her child can make that pain of labor worth it. They're connected. And any parent or grandparent, aunt or uncle or guardian knows that the love we have for a child can make us terrifyingly vulnerable to the pain that child can cause us, or the pain of the possibility of losing that child. You see that on the front of this morning's bulletin in the artwork there, Michelangelo's Pietà. The Blessed Mother Mary embraces the body of Christ, her son, embracing not only the deep pain she must have felt in that moment, but also her deep love for him. There is a profound reciprocity between suffering and love, and by embracing one, we embrace at least the possibility of the other. But in doing so, we also say that it is better to know love, even with the possibility of suffering, than to live a pain-free and loveless life. By embracing pain, by becoming active participants in our life and in our world, even in the midst of our suffering, by loving fully and openly, even when that opens us up to the possibility of being hurt, by following Jesus in the way of love, even when that way leads us towards the suffering of others, or through our own pain, or to the cross. Even when the way of love is hard and at times hurts, by embracing pain, our own and others, we proclaim that our love for God and our love for others is worth it. And not only worth it, but maybe even a way to heal it. Researchers have found that too, that as much pain and hurt as love can cause, it can also has an equally powerful ability to heal and to relieve pain. You know this, when you embrace a child who's been hurt, it makes them feel better. Studies have found holding a loved one's hand during a painful procedure can actually relieve the pain. It can be the beginning of healing, and not just somebody else. In 2011, Dee Parvaz, an Iranian-American journalist, saw the beginnings of the civil war in Syria. She was sent there to report on it, to find out more, but she was soon arrested and taken blindfolded and handcuffed to a compound where she was interrogated, where she heard others being tortured all around her. In particular, one voice that she said sounded obscenely young, teenage boy howling in pain, swearing he did not know anything, that he hadn't done anything, crying out to God, crying out for his mother, until his screams abruptly stopped. She languished there until eventually she was released and extradited and then eventually returned to her family. Of course, when she flung herself into her job, not out of some noble sense of duty, but really to avoid dealing with the trauma, at least to numb herself from the pain of it, to fend off the feeling that she had had in that cell, the suffering that she had experienced and encountered. She took every assignment she could, tried to keep herself busy, putting up a wall between anybody or anything she was reporting on, never getting too emotionally attached, until she went to Egypt a few years later, where the Egyptian government had cleared protests with unabated violence. Slaughter of 20 million people in broad daylight in a world capital. She went to one of the mosques where bodies were being kept, hundreds of them, so that loved ones could hopefully identify them. And with a translator, she starts talking to this woman whose husband was among the dead. The woman is describing the last phone conversation she had with him, which was right as the shooting started. He was unarmed, she said, a devoted husband, a father of four. And as this woman is talking, Dee is scribbling furiously on her notepad, not wanting to miss a single detail. But then the translator stops, even as the woman is still talking, and Dee looks up at him like, "Dude, what?" And he leans in and whispers to her, "Now would be a good time for you to put an arm around her." She thinks, "That's not how this works. I'm a reporter. I don't hug you for you to tell me your story," but the look on her translator's face says, "Get over yourself." So she robotically puts her arm around this woman, and the second her hand touches her, the woman collapses into Dee's chest, sobbing as she holds on. And Dee realized it didn't matter what kind of reporting rules she had. This woman just wanted somebody to register what was happening to her, to bear witness to what she had been through. She just needed somebody to embrace her pain. And when she collapsed into Dee's arms, that wall that Dee had put up between herself and anybody else, between herself and others' pain, between herself and her own pain, it collapsed. And as painful as that was for her, it was also the beginning of her healing. As we walk through life, as we walk in the way of Jesus, we will encounter and experience suffering. And we can do our best to avoid it, but we never will, not completely. We can try our best to numb it, but we will deaden our capacity for joy and love too. We can get to the point where we accept it, maybe begrudgingly or reluctantly, passively. Or we can embrace it, holding on to one another and holding on to God, who is always holding on to us, no matter what. That is the call of Christ, to take up our cross and follow. And that is the invitation to each and every one of us today. The invitation to follow Christ to the cross and perhaps to the new life that lies beyond. It is an invitation to new life, to a new way of living, to the way of love, a way that will entail some pain, as all life does, but a way that ultimately leads to healing as we hold on to God and hold on to one another and journey together to the cross and beyond. If you would like to respond to that invitation, we will celebrate that with you, and we will walk with you. We will hold on to you. as we walk together and journey together in the way of Christ. And if you would like to make a public response today, I'll be here at the front to receive you and welcome you. If you'd like to come forward, or for our folks watching online, leave us a comment, send us an email, and we will support you and walk with you this whole journey through. Like I said, I'll be here at the front as we stand and sing. Let's just sing this first verse of our closing hymn, "Wherever He Leads, I'll Go." Let's stand together. Other, which binds us together now and always. So as we go, we pray that God would give us grace. Grace never to sell ourselves short. Grace to risk something big for something good. Grace to remember that the world is too dangerous for anything but truth, and too small for anything but love. So may God take our minds and think through them. May God take our lips and speak through them. May God take our hands and work through them. And may God take our hearts and set them on fire this day, every day, and forevermore. Amen. Go in peace. And thank you all for joining us from wherever you are. We hope to see you soon. Take care, and take care of one another. Bye-bye.